Hey, good morning, everybody. This is Richard Sachs here on the Q&A show, special show in addition to the regular Lost Arts radio show. This is a show for Saturday morning. It's the 21st of May, 2016. We're here with Doug Diamond from DiamondDiscAudio.com, holding the show together. And tomorrow night, I wanted to remind you that we have an amazing show coming up with our friend Dr. Rima Labo, but she's bringing her husband, retired General Bert Stubblebine, who was very high up in the military establishment and came over to work with her on healing the world in a number of ways. They worked against Codex Alimentarius, trying to stop the restriction on nutrition and supplements, and now just general education work and working to get things turned around from what government and its partner global corporations are doing to humanity. So definitely a show that'll be worth hearing tomorrow night, 8 o'clock Pacific, right at the same place here, blogtalkradio.com/Lost Arts Radio, 11 o'clock Eastern, every Sunday night. And I'm really thinking of proposing to them that we do an additional show aimed specifically at inviting defectors from within the establishment to join us in stopping the total destruction of the biosphere and humanity. I think that would be a good idea to not have that get completed. So there are some positive things happening in the outside world right now, in addition to the acceleration of all of the assaults on humanity, which I think indicates that the global leaders, you know, not the real ones, but the ones who have humanity in bondage at the moment, they really feel like there's a danger of humanity waking up, and that's why they're accelerating their attacks. So I got an email this morning that some of you actually might have gotten also from Jeffrey Smith, one of the premier world leaders in the fight against GMOs and to get the food supply back so that it's edible again. And he's pointing out that the GMO tipping point, which is where there's just so much demand for clean food and so little demand for GMOs, that even the companies with absolutely no ethics, no conscience, no morals whatsoever, except just, you know, make money by hurting humanity. And there's a lot of those huge companies right now, all over the world, that they finally figure out there's just not money to be made in certain kinds of poison, such as GMOs, which masquerade as being scientific advance. They're complete crime against humanity. That they realize there's not enough money in that, and they start actually selling real food instead. And Jeffrey, in the email this morning, listed a bunch of major global companies that are starting to sell GMO-free products. They're changing their food over to GMO-free. And there's a deadline coming up soon, I think it's in July, in Vermont, when the law goes into effect, that they have to have at least all of the GMO ingredients in food has to be labeled. You know, obviously it should be banned from the planet, certainly from this country and any country that cares about the well-being of its citizens. I mean, the people in ruling it care about that, which is rare. Russia is setting a great example under Putin by banning GMOs, at least, I think it was for a 10-year period, while they figure things out further, which is great. It's a good start. Banning is much more intelligent than labeling. But labeling, as Jeffrey Smith points out, can lead to banning. Actually, even without banning, it can lead to companies figuring it's not worth having the label on their product and getting the bad name from it, because too many of the public are becoming aware that GMOs are not edible, that they're poisonous, that they cause organ damage, cancer, total infertility in 3 generations in test animals. I mean, nobody sane would ever consider them to be edible, let alone some kind of scientific advance. And yet, just because of the money, there are people within the biotech industry willing to tell themselves this kind of nonsense and not let themselves look at the actual truth, which underneath they know all about. We've all heard the stories about the upper management of the GMO companies and the biotech industry having the I'm sorry, I'm not really good at multitasking here, but I just got a private text from Dr. Rima Lebo, our guest tomorrow night, and it sounds like she's interested in doing an additional show about encouraging defectors directly from these major industries, biotech being one of them. And I think we need to do everything we can to make use of the time because, you know, as all of the conscious, real positive world leaders point out, we don't really know how much time we've got before it's too late to save life on this planet. And it's really hanging by a thread to that degree. So every one of us has a responsibility, if we want to help with that, to start by looking inside ourselves, improving, you know, our lifestyle, improving our health, improving our mental clarity. All of these things go together, of course, so that we can contribute more in whatever areas we feel are important. If we're lazy in our own life and then we go out and work for a cause, we're really severely handicapped in what we're able to contribute. So, I also wanted to say that with respect to the GMO situation, that banning GMOs, even if they could be not just labeled, but banned and just totally thrown out, that's only going to work if we have a huge renaissance of small organic family farms starting everywhere. And it has to start immediately. People need to be growing food everywhere they can. If you have no possible place to grow food anywhere, and all you have is a jar maybe to grow sprouts in, that's a start, because the sprouts can be organic. Get organic seed. And, you know, just do something to get back in touch with nature. Walk on the ground barefoot whenever you can. Not on, you know, dangerous places. Not in places that they're totally sprayed and, you know, sharp objects and stuff. But where it's safe, you have good grass and nice sand and clean streams, things like that. Get grounded. It changes your mentality. It changes your blood chemistry within an hour. But actually, Dr. Laura Conover, the intuition physician that I'd strongly recommend that you look up on a search engine and find out what she's doing, got amazing work. She'll probably be a guest on the show eventually. She said she's really into grounding and says that within a few minutes or even seconds of walking barefoot on the ground or touching a tree with your hand, because the tree is grounded into the ground, your blood chemistry starts to change. The configuration of your red blood cells begins to change. And, you know, it's just really good. But beyond the physical, measurable changes like that, it changes what's happening in your mind instantaneously. So I would really recommend it. It's similar to getting fresh air for the electrical system of your body. So all of it, even if we can't be small farmers ourselves, we can do little things like that. Get sun exposure. You know that's important because government is telling you to avoid it at all costs, that it causes cancer and kills you. Obviously, God made a big mistake, or if you don't believe in God, then nature made a big mistake in creating the sun, right? Because it's actually killing you. But this may not be the actual fact of the situation. The sun is probably one of the most essential nutrients, I would say, shortly after prana or chi energy. As far as physical nutrients go, the sun is probably right at the top. And it needs to be in your eyes and on your skin as many days out of the year as possible. It does not mean stare at the sun. Although later, when your body is very clean and well-nourished, that's very easy to do. I mean, I can tell you from experience that becomes easy to do it at midday. But do not try that at home or anywhere else until you're really at that stage. And I want to remind you that we don't give medical advice here, okay? So this is just for information, entertainment. It's just a regular old person sharing some impressions and observations and experience, which at the moment is still legal, even in the U.S., although we don't know for how much longer. So ultimately, every single one of you has to become in direct connection with the internal guidance that every one of us has ourselves. Take advantage of the outside things while you have them, but the inside things are what's going to be with you forever. And I recommend getting strongly in touch with that. By the way, when I stop all the talking, we may take some phone calls. And if you feel like calling in about any of these ideas that we're talking about or have talked about in the past and feel like applying them to your own life, then you're welcome to do that on this show. We don't usually have time for call-ins on the Sunday evening show, but we started this one because people had asked for that to be available. And that number, if you ever want to call in and talk about how to apply some of these things in your own personal situation, is 657-383-1002. That's 657-383-1002. I've kind of forgotten to mention it for the last several weeks, so I apologize for that. I just get kind of wrapped up in the ideas that we're talking about. But it would be nice to hear from you if you feel like discussing anything that you're dealing with or issues with applying some of these things to specific health and life and consciousness situations. Because that's the whole point. Deal with the ones that you've got internally, and your effectiveness on the outside world will exponentially increase. So let me see. And we were talking about growing food. We want to get real education out there. That's really, you know, the primary purpose of this show, is because education is a really exciting thing, as real educators and real students know. It's a lifelong thing that makes your life exciting. And instead of that, you know, somehow we ended up with government education centers, government indoctrination centers, I shouldn't call them education, in this country and most of the so-called developed world. When the country started, families were teaching their kids. And I'm sure the Native Americans were doing this for, you know, a long, long time before the people got here from other countries. But even in the early settler communities, either parents would teach their own kids, or if they didn't personally have time to do it, they'd get a small group within their town and they'd set up, you know, a local private schoolhouse and they'd do it there. And it would be things relevant to life and, you know, basic skills having to do with reading and writing and arithmetic, like, you know, was originally taught in school. And education used to be relevant, useful, and interesting. They'd read classic great works in literature. And, you know, just the opposite is happening now. So one of the things we're trying to make a small contribution to on this radio show is real education. And just talking about growing food, you know, all of these areas have become so corrupted. It's just incredible. You know, chemical fertilizer was apparently started by this guy, Justus von Liebig, a German chemist. Justus was J-U-S-T-U-S, at least the English spelling. And Justus von Liebig, he found out that if you take three elements on the periodic table, which are nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium, and you put those in where the plant can get them, hopefully in water-soluble form so they go right into the plant, then you don't even have to have good soil. The plant grows fast. The farmer can grow it quickly. He can get more money because it weighs more in less time, and everybody's happy. And the only problem that he didn't foresee, because he was very superficial in his approach to this whole thing, even though he thought he was a brilliant scientist and chemist, is that there's a whole universe of microorganisms in healthy soil that's delicately balanced to put exactly the right nutritional qualities into the plant to keep it healthy, and also to keep any animal or human that eats the plant healthy. And it's not a chaotic random system. It works perfectly. And when you mess it up and you put these harsh chemicals in the soil, in this case, chemical forms of nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium, it totally messes up the ecosystem of the microorganisms in the soil. And you get sick plants, for one thing, which is great for the pesticide industry, because they say, see, this is a deficiency in poison. You need to spray the plants to bring everything back to normal and help nature out. And of course, that makes it much worse. And so the plant gets unbalanced nutritionally, and the people that eat it start getting sick. And it makes an incredible global mess. And this is way before GMOs were ever imagined. It's even before the pesticides really got going. Chemical fertilizers have been an absolute disaster for the whole planet from day one. And before the end of his life, you can look this up. Justice von Liebig said he was really sorry about the chemical fertilizer thing, that to paraphrase Bill Murray in Ghostbusters. I'm sure he didn't say it in those words, but he was saying that he made a mistake and that chemical fertilizers were terrible and that they should never be produced or used. But it was too late because there was a big industry going, another outlet for petroleum, basically. And, to get the nitrogen, which is in volume, the primary nutrient that they try to put in fertilizer, there's one source for nitrogen on the whole planet. I don't know if you are all aware of that or not. You might be. So raise your hand if you know what source that is. And, the correct answer is that it comes from the air. And that in a healthy atmosphere, the way it's supposed to be, without the chemtrails in it, it's got about 20% roughly of oxygen. But that leaves 4/5 of it not oxygen. And what's that supposed to be? Well, primarily nitrogen. And then there are bacteria in the soil called nitrogen-fixing bacteria and other microorganisms that can grab that nitrogen right out of the air and bring it into their tissues in the ground. And then the plant root hairs, that means the smallest roots, get connected to those microorganisms, and it's like a bridge feeding nitrogen directly into the plant. And that's how nature fertilizes the forests and all the vast majority of the ground that at least at this point are not being chemically fertilized, but they're doing fine. And they've got an unlimited reservoir of nitrogen fertilizer in the air, and you're breathing it. And it's absolutely necessary for your body to stay healthy as well. If you try to have a normal lifetime breathing oxygen, it does not work. It has to be mixed in the right ratio with nitrogen and some other small amounts of healthy things as well. So Justice von Liebig made a big mistake trying to manipulate nature and put this nitrogen via a factory into a solid form that you could spread on the soil, which is super harsh for the microorganisms in the soil and the earthworms and everything else. It really messes it up, and it makes the plant grow really fast with practically no nutritional value compared to if it were done naturally. And he caused massive harm with his so-called scientific advance. And one of the things that he was indirectly helping to happen was the birth of the pesticide industry. Because the way that nature works, the bugs are not a big mistake of nature. They're in there so that if there are plants that are growing with unbalanced nutrition, or maybe in a place where there's standing water and the roots can't get the oxygen they need, anything that makes the plant unhealthy, the insects tune in on that immediately. They know their job so well. They're just incredibly inspirational, and humans could learn a lot from insects and from microorganisms. But they are very receptive. They know where the plants are growing with unbalanced nutrition or other things that make them weak, and they go in and eliminate them so that the plant species does not become weak as a whole. And it results in a very healthy plant community. But see, what happens if you use chemical fertilizers on a field of crops, and especially if there's just one crop there, like a whole field of corn, which is extremely unnatural, then that corn is not going to be growing with the right nutrition. And you can grow a monocrop of corn if you switch it around once in a while, but without a problem. But if you do it with chemical fertilizer, and again, this is way before GMOs ever came in the picture, then the corn doesn't have the nutrients in it needs. The insects know that. They come in, try to eat the corn to get rid of it. And the chemical dealer says, you see, you didn't have the right kind of poison to make the crop healthy, and now you've got all these bugs, so you have to spray it constantly with these deadly toxins. But don't worry that they're on your food. They're really not harmful in any way, and they're government approved. That's what happened to agriculture before GMOs. So, you know, agriculture schools are still teaching that chemical fertilizers are great. You just have to analyze things really carefully to figure out how to manipulate nature the best way. And then, of course, alfalfa, or, you know, well, I was jumping ahead. Any crop that you're growing with the chemical fertilizers is almost certainly going to need pesticides, because it's so messed up nutritionally that the insects are going to come and try to eliminate it. So you've got to kill them, and you need to become a big poison customer. This is what's happening to the entire food system of the developed countries, and then the developed countries make believe, in the leaders of them make believe they're helping the non-developed countries by sending them the poison food to share. And then the medical industry does great as a result, because everybody gets degenerative disease and sinks into an old age that is absolutely hellish and that we're supposed to think is normal. So this is just a tiny piece of what's happening that I wanted to share, because we started talking about growing food. Now, when you introduce GMOs into that whole picture, it gets way worse. I mean, you have to be a master criminal to even come up with the idea of GMOs. And it's not the scientists working on it that were the master criminals. They just are indoctrinated from what they learned in school. They think they're really cutting-edge scientists, and they just follow orders to do whatever, you know, atrocity they're told from higher up, and they can't see anything wrong with it in general. But the people who are designing and running these systems, they are totally aware, and they're aware now, that GMOs cause organ damage, they cause cancer, they cause total destruction of fertility. I think it was hamsters. They, you know, these poor innocent hamsters, unfortunately, were subjected to eating GMO corn, I think it was corn and or soybeans, and three generations, along with all the other disastrous effects, the babies were just gone. No more babies at all. Before that, they started having birth defects and dead babies and things like that at birth, but by three generations, they couldn't breed at all. And that's where humans are going. And when you actually get the picture of what's going on with that, it's practically unbelievable. Because we've been trained to think that our leaders are benevolent and that they're doing everything that they can for our benefit. That's not entirely accurate, to put it mildly. So in order to counteract that, because it's not good enough to just complain about what's going on, you have to actually figure out what to do to make it better. And I think that's our job. You know, if we're fortunate enough to become aware of what's happening and what these nefarious plans by the leaders are actually producing, because none of this stuff is happening by chance or bad luck or anything like that, or because the scientists made an honest mistake. It's nothing like that. It's totally intentional. And as we've said many times, the conspiracy theory people are completely wrong, you know, because it's way more organized and way more intentional and much worse situation than they can imagine, because they just know pieces of it. But even those pieces are enough to give you a clue. So, you know, if you see how the agriculture system works and then you see the opposite of how it's supposed to work, you know that there's this just incredible, overwhelming, awesome beauty in nature that is on a depth that humans don't even begin to perceive. And the way that the soil's put together, I've had an opportunity to be involved in an experiment lately with a system that came partly from Paul Gauchy, who was on our show in Washington State, remember, with the wood chips. If you haven't seen him, I know nobody has time for much of anything, but if you get to ever listen to an archive, that's a really good one where we interviewed Paul Gauchy. I don't remember what show that was, but it'll come up easy on YouTube if you just put it in. And what Paul made an amazing discovery. He didn't want to, you know, he already knew not to use agricultural chemicals ever under any circumstances, and no poison or anything, but it doesn't make you an organic gardener or farmer to stop using poison and fertilizer. You have to then learn from scratch how you do grow plants and how you do, you know, help nature come back to its normal state. And he moved from the Los Angeles area where he was gardening for a long time, and he moved up to Washington State, and he got... Doug is just letting me know. Thank you very much, Doug. Paul Gauchy was on June 6th of 2015, a year ago, and it was show number 22. So anybody that gets a chance to watch that, thank you very much, Doug. Anybody who gets a chance to watch that, I think you'll like it. Anyway, what I was saying is he moved up to Washington State to get his family away from a not very good environment that had developed in Los Angeles, which used, by the way, Los Angeles used to be super beautiful, where doctors sent their patients to recover from lung problems because the air was so good. And that was a while back, but that really is what it used to be like. So he moved his family to Washington State, Northwest Washington, and everybody thinks that is, you know, wet all the time, but he was in a rain shadow area, which means low rainfall. And they drilled a well, and the well had hardly any water. So he's really disappointed because he had to garden up there. And so he explains it, that he was talking to God and saying, what am I supposed to do? And he said God showed him the forest, because all the trees there were doing just fine, you know, fir trees and other ones. And they were in the same low rainfall area. And he walked over there, and he found out that, you know, when you've walked in a forest, generally, if humans have not been there and messed it up, the ground is just covered with the debris from the falling pine needles and leaves and branches that have decomposed and over a very long period of time. And that's not some kind of waste mistake that, you know, God or nature couldn't figure out how to get rid of that stuff. It's there because it's making fertilizer. And nobody else is putting anything on it. And the tree roots have taken these minerals from deep in the earth, combined them with the elements from the air and the water and the sun, turned them into leaves, and then the leaves die and the branches die and they fall on the ground and they decompose. And so Paul walked over there right next to his property, and he put his hand down and it just sank into the soil like somebody had been digging it up, you know, 24 hours a day to keep it soft. But obviously that had not happened, and it was full of earthworms. It was smelled great. You know what it smells like when you go in a forest? That's the normal smell of the earth, and that's supposed to be all over. I mean, it might vary a little because some places are deserts or forests or other things, but they all smell incredible. And that aromatherapy that's natural, that we're supposed to be breathing all day and night, is part of what keeps us in our normal state of health. So anyway, Paul observed this happening, and he got wood chips from, I guess, a tree trimming company or something like that. And those companies are all over the country. I've found some here as well, even in the Southwest. And it not bark chips, okay, because bark chips is too specific. There's a lot of the elements that you need in the actual wood and the leaves and everything. So if it's all ground up together, he got it and he spread it deeply all over his whole property. I think he may have gotten it wet once, or it rained once. But after that, the water requirement, of course, was cut by about 95% by the fact that it was covered with the wood chips. And over time, they started decomposing into the soil, actually quite quickly. And he was able to grow his entire garden, and it survived droughts and produced the incredible quality food. And now he's got visitors from all over the world just coming to see his amazing garden. And there's a free movie online at backtoedenfilm.com. I highly recommend that everybody see it. It's really inspiring. Remind you what agriculture is supposed to look like. I mean, it's really different than what agriculture has become. And now we've got these multi-billion dollar industries like the agricultural fertilizer industry that are making sure that it doesn't go back to normal. But I think that we have to find a way to turn it back. Not so much by being against things as being for things that will replace them and just completely make them irrelevant. So there's this huge parallel between the agricultural industry and the medical industry, because I hope people are interested in this kind of stuff. I think it's really incredibly important and fascinating. So you can let me know. And if you want to give me feedback, Richard at Lost Arts Radio, I read every email and will respond to as many as I can. Really like to know whether I'm striking a chord with anybody out there, or whether I'm just, you know, kind of rambling on about stuff that nobody cares about. But to me, you know, I've spent many decades looking for how these things work, trying to understand them, trying to understand our normal state of health, and not just in theory, but experimentally, and getting back to it so that we don't need the degenerative disease. You don't need to end up, you know, totally incapacitated in what's called normal old age, which it's not, forgetting who you are and all this nonsense that we're not supposed to have to go through that. The body is designed as a self-healing organism. It's not a tractor. It has consciousness in it. Every cell, every atom has consciousness. And what that does is it makes it all pull toward normal, pull toward healing. It's not just a bunch of random chemical reactions. So anyway, I was talking about the parallel between chemical farming and drug medicine. Because in the farming, they say, oh, great, you know, all we have to do is, like Justice von Liebig originally said, put in the fertilizers like nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium, abbreviated N, P, and K on the periodic table, and some other ones, the sophisticated ones, get into putting some trace elements on and things like that. And they try to manipulate things with constant soil testing and everything to get it to what they think is ideal, which they think nature, you know, can't do that because nature's not an advanced scientist. And the result is plants that may grow fast and look like they're okay if you're a very superficial observer, but they draw insects, which require poisoning your food, which is not brilliant. And then, you know, they have all kinds of trouble. And they become susceptible to droughts, and they don't do nearly as well as organic plants do under stress. Lot of problems. So in drug medicine, what happens is that the food that people are eating now is like the chemical fertilizer of the plants. And when the people eat that food, it's got stimulants and special chemical flavors and all this stuff in it that you appear to do well because you feel all energized right after you eat it, but very quickly you develop more and more problems. You become susceptible to infectious diseases, which you're not supposed to be. The normal human immune system can fight off virtually any infectious disease, possibly even the weaponized ones that our rulers are coming up with, like the Ebola that the health authorities created in West Africa and released on the public to experiment. You know, a lot of other things, the swine flu that they've genetically put together. The human immune system is so strong that it can fight off most of those things naturally. But when we're eating the chemicalized food, excuse me, then it's just like the plants being fed chemical fertilizer, and we're susceptible to everything. It's not really that complex to understand. And then what happens is when the infectious diseases come, which is not by chance, You know, those microorganisms, just like the insects in the field, the microorganisms sense waste products and poison in the body, and they're pulled there. They do their job, and they come in to break down those poisons. And the byproducts of that process can also be harmful, because it's not supposed to be going on in a healthy body at all. So, it looks like the insects in the field and the microorganisms in the body just show up, you know, by at random chance, and that's totally not true. In fact, at this point, it really looks to me like there's absolutely nothing that is happening at random or by chance. And it's up to us to see the significance of events in our lives or around us or other people that we meet. Everything means something. And it shows you our degree of consciousness, you know, by the fact that we have almost no clue what anything means anymore. We just memorize things in our government indoctrination camps, and then we try to understand life and reality from that, and it does not work. It makes a lot of trouble. So, you know, when the insects get the chemically fertilized crops and cause that problem, then the farmer is told to spray with poison, which makes things much worse, even though it does kill the insects. And it opens up the crop to all kinds of other trouble. And, of course, now you have a polluted crop that's poison. The same thing with the person that gets the infectious disease, with the microorganisms just trying to come do their job because they sense waste and toxins in the body that need to be broken down, and they come to do that. That's an infectious disease. And the doctor says, oh, you need to have internal poison, just like spraying the corn crop. And it's called antibiotics, or it's called other kinds of drugs that kill the evil microorganisms, right, as if they're not there for any reason. And what happens is the microorganisms are killed, the person gets over the immediate situation. But most of the immune system, which is being held together by the microorganisms that are supposed to be in your gut primarily, they get killed or damaged as well, and then you're susceptible to all kinds of other diseases. And if you're getting the average drugs or most of the vaccines, they all have other poisons in them, which cause all kinds of other problems. And it just gets worse and worse for everybody except the bottom line of the medical industry and the people above the medical industry that designed and approved the whole thing. And at that level, it's not about money. It's about the agenda that they have for the earth, which is basically total destruction. It's not ultimate profit, because they print the money. They're not out there trying to find it. They use gold and silver as their money anyway. They don't use fiat currency, except on the lowest level to interact with the lower class people, meaning all of us. But for themselves, they have gold and silver and land and solid things that don't get devalued. And at their level, the objective is not complex. You know, we're really trained to think that it must be really mysterious. No, they actually worship destruction, pain, suffering, and death. That's it. And some of them actually approach it like a religious, attitude. And it, you know, it's been described as satanic worship of different kinds. But whatever you want to call it, it's just that they actually are attached to causing as much pain as they possibly can. And they intend to wipe out normal life on the planet. And they're doing it right in front of our eyes, while we sit there saying, wonder what they're really trying to do. Do we think it's a scientific mistake they're trying to correct? Are they trying to save us from global warming? Are they trying to save us from famine with GMOs? Are they trying to protect the world for democracy by bombing other countries? No, they're trying to kill us. Sorry, but it's really that simple. So, and I think at this point, while we have been kind of out of it and not knowing what's going on, not seeing the obvious in front of our face, thanks partly to our education and partly to the media and partly to so many other things, the fake science and all that, they've gotten to the point now where they have pretty bad weapons, you know, much more than what we've seen. And I don't think it's a good plan to try to set things right by force or violence in any form. So that's kind of out of the question for anybody sensible. So we have to be creative enough to come up with something better than that. And that's our challenge, really. It's not just to run around, you know, seeing only one foot in front of us all the time or get through the day or stuff like that. I mean, that is important. It helps a lot to get through the day. But we actually have purpose for being here. And since things have gotten to the point where it's almost, we're looking at possible extinction for humans and other species on the planet, we, no matter how busy we are trying to survive and deal with the immediate issues in our life, we're the ones who are supposed to take time in, you know, even for 1 minute in between two things that you have to do, and look for creative solutions to, like Michael Jackson said, heal the world. And he was an example of musicians that are eliminated because they give people the wrong ideas, such as harmony, peace, love, that everybody is one family or actually one being. Things like that can't be allowed to get into the public consciousness. So Michael Jackson, John Lennon, many other, you know, Bob Marley, other musicians are killed, just like politicians that get out of line, like John Kennedy. But if each one of us is actually working inside of ourselves to contact that source that we are originally came from and get connected to that and let it flow through us, that's something that ultimately the rulers can't stop. And my idea as of this morning, talking to Dr. Labo, was that we should start inviting people directly from inside the power structure, low level, high level, wherever they are. And they don't even have to outwardly say anything, but to realize, to realize they're making a mistake. It's not just because we happen to be the victims and we don't like that and we'd rather not be killed by them. It's that for them too, this is a big mistake to actually try to pursue the path that they're on, because there's an old law of nature, and I say old, that's an understatement. I'm sure at this point that it's from when humans first started on this planet, and that is that it's part of the design principles by which we were all put together. And it says, whatever we do to someone else or for someone else comes back to us multiplied. And there are many ways that this is said. It's picked up on by religions. It's called karma. It's called as you sow shall you reap. What goes around comes around, all these things. But it's operating in nature. It doesn't matter whether you believe in it. It's working all the time. So if you are part of these groups that knowingly are working to hurt others, whether it's for money or not is entirely secondary, then you're not making a good future for yourself. And it's not because, you know, some authority, you know, a picture of God sitting on a cloud is going to throw a lightning bolt at you or, you know, throw you into hell forever because he loves you so much because you made a mistake. It's because internally to you, in your own consciousness, where you cannot escape it because it's you, your consciousness is watching everything you do every second, and it's recording all of it, and it's going to react to it. So because of where you came from and that you're not really evil, and you get away from your source, you get out of harmony with who you're really supposed to be, your own consciousness at a deeper level is not going to allow that indefinitely. So sooner or later, if you're doing that, it's going to pull you into experiences that are going to be as severe and shocking as necessary to get you back on track. And you may not appreciate the process at the time because it can be pretty intense. And I'm sure all of us have gone through parts of it already. So it would be very wise on the part of the power structure people that are involved in hurting us and killing us right now to reconsider the direction they're going and saying even if they only care about themselves, that's fine. Because if you care about only yourself, that's no problem. If you realize what really helps you, you're going to immediately do everything possible to help, serve, and love the people around you. And this is what I've explained in the past, that in a way, there's no difference between selfishness and selflessness at all. It's degrees of wisdom and awareness. And with that, everybody is selfish 100%. There is no one ever in history that did anything other than exactly what they wanted to do. But the people with no consciousness, they think they're serving themselves by hurting other people. And this is not intelligent for the reason we just said. The people who become wiser realize that every time they help someone else, they are literally helping themselves. And so they are the ones that are serving themselves the most. And when they say they're serving the source inside themselves or their creator or God or spirit or whatever is the source that they ultimately came from, there's no faster and more complete way to help yourself that I think ever existed. So the people internal to the power structure, if they really want to help themselves, they have to help us. And we want to get that through to those that are ready to hear the message. And if we can get some of them switching around, we need every little bit of help like that we can get at this point. So bringing ourselves back in harmony with nature or with spirit or where we came from is the key to everything else. And if we want to help the outside world, we have to change what we're doing inside ourselves first. And what we're going to also, tomorrow night when we talk to General Burt and Dr. Rima, which I think is going to be incredible, and if you guys get a chance to listen live or to the archive, I highly recommend it. 6 o'clock p.m. Pacific, 9 o'clock Eastern, Sunday night. It's going to be a great show. And it turns out that General Burt worked on areas of intentionality and healing. And it goes exactly together with a lot of what we talk about in the sense that we are always setting our intention on something. And because we're transmitters of energy on a very fine level, this has a massive impact. And there's kind of a law of nature also. There are many interesting ones, but one is that the more subtle something is, the more powerful it is, and or potentially powerful. So the idea that we are electrical beings, I mean, this is even known by physicists. You don't have to believe in anything to know this. I mean, it's just true. There are very fine electrical potentials that go between all of the cells and the brain. The whole nervous system operates electrically. And if you stop the electrical system in the body, there's no life left. It's absolutely essential for life. And it turns out that there are electrical fields measurable by normal means around the body. Every one of us is putting them out. But what is discovered only by some of the more advanced quantum physicists and other teachers on other levels is that we are transmitting from emotion and thought 24 hours a day, even while we're apparently dreaming, and we're also receiving. And we're going to get an example of that in a minute. But so the thing is to change it from unconscious and chaotic to conscious. And there are people on the negative side of the power structure that are aware of this also. And so they want to use this kind of transmission because they know it's real. It's not a theory. And they want to use it to cause damage and harm and intimidation and fear and all this kind of stuff. But if we get in touch with the natural transmitting ability that we have of thought and energy internally to ourselves. That is so powerful that there are ways to develop that so that the negatively directed ones cannot possibly get into us and they just bounce off. So with that in mind, Doug, are you up to going over your experience again like you did before so that the people who listen live or hear this as an archive might get some benefit by hearing what you went through? Is that a possibility?
Yeah, you want to do that now or in a little bit?
I would really like to because I think it fits together, you know, with what I just said, that people might not believe that everybody is transmitting and receiving very fine energy that shows up inside your mind and your whole body. And you had an experience of the less desirable part of that as part of an overall experience that I think illustrates that this kind of thing is real.
Yeah.
And, you know, and I think the whole experience that you went through is really valuable for people to hear about. And I want everybody to get some benefit from that if they can.
Okay. Well, yeah. April 11th. So just a few weeks ago, I was in a terrible car accident. I had picked up my daughter at school. We were on our way home. Just her and I. And we were on a rain-soaked road, and a truck and trailer, not a semi, but a pickup truck, with a trailer full of, like, landscaping equipment, crossed the center line and struck us, hit us on the driver's side. I don't know if it T-boned us or if it smashed into us head first or exactly what happened, because I don't remember really any of the whole thing. I only know what people told me afterwards. So the guy that was driving that truck smashed into us and spun us around, and we smashed into a concrete post and snapped that off. And it really hurt me pretty bad. I had quite a few injuries. Luckily, praise God, my daughter had really zero injuries. She had a bruise from her seatbelt, which she was wearing, luckily. So she didn't really suffer any major injuries. I seem to have taken the brunt of that, which is fine with me. As her dad, I would gladly do that for her. Our little dog that was with us was severely injured, and we had to put her to sleep. So that was the most heartbreaking part of the whole thing, was losing our dog. But Jenna was fine, and I'm doing better. I had to, they had to take me by ambulance to trauma at the hospital at Vanderbilt, and ended up having to go through a couple of different surgeries. The impact from the accident was great enough that it snapped my ball and socket on my left hip and basically dislocated it and pushed it through the main part of my hip. So that had to be repaired in surgery. And I had a few other injuries as well. I had a fracture, couple fractured ribs, and a spinal neck issue that they did surgery on to correct. And a fracture behind my left knee. So all that to say, I am getting around very slowly, but at least I can get around. I'm currently using a wheelchair and walker and things like that just to maneuver around in our house. But at least I'm back home and can manage with a lot of help from my wife and others. So the interesting thing that we were talking about with Dr. Rima was that exactly 1 month prior to the accident on March 11th, and I know it was March 11th because I told several people what had happened. And it was date stamped, so I knew exactly what happened. March 11th, I had a very vivid dream that told me that something was going to happen. Now, what transpired in the dream was, as I remember it, was that someone, I understood it to be either military or member of some sort of agency of some sort, probably black ops type of agency, you know, something that's not ever mentioned by anyone, whether it's NSA or worse, you know. I understood it to be someone like that, and he was typing a message to me, and I could hear it in my head audibly. So as he typed, it was turning into a voice in my head, and it was really interesting because I'd never had a dream like this. It was very vivid, like I said. And he was typing me a message, and he said, I need to stop what I was doing or else. Now, I do a lot of posting on Facebook, and just in life in general, I try and tell people about truth, whether it's truth about vaccines or truth about geoengineering or any of the subjects that we cover on Lost Arts Radio. Anything Alex Jones talks about, I put a lot of that information out there. And they told me in the stream to stop doing it. And my first question was, how are you communicating with me? How can I hear you when you're just typing to me?
Yeah, and I just want to mention that it's really great that you were so conscious in your dream that you were able to, you know, just like in daily life, turn around and ask, what are you doing, you know, instead of just kind of going with it.
Yeah. Well, I'm that type of person that really likes to understand how things work. So apparently even in my dream, I was, you know, doing the same thing. I wanted to understand it. And he said to me, you already know how I'm doing this because you talk about it all the time. He says it's happening from the stuff you're breathing, the chemtrails, the geoengineering, the nanotechnology that's all part of that system. And he also told me that they can track anyone because everybody breathes. They can track anyone using their DNA. And they have records of everybody. So he was pretty forthright, told me all that. He wasn't, he didn't come across as an evil person. It was only ever one person. So it kind of shook me just because he told me that something bad was going to happen if I don't stop.
So he was, it sounds like he was kind of like a technician doing what he was told, but, you know, just doing his job basically.
Yeah. I didn't really feel threatened from him directly, but more the idea of the whole thing.
Right.
So I woke up and remember thinking, man, that was really realistic, and I don't know if I want any more of this dream to happen. I was awake for a few minutes and then did go back to sleep, and the dream continued where it left off, which is really strange.
Was it in the middle of the night, Doug, or in the morning?
Okay. Yeah, it was in the early morning hours. At that time, I would go to bed at, you know, 1 a.m., so it was probably, I don't know, 4 or 5 in the morning or so.
Okay.
On the 11th.
Right.
So, anyway, part two of the dream was essentially him threatening my daughter. And I don't remember it lasting very long, but one of the most interesting parts of the whole thing to me is that it was myself and my daughter in the vehicle a month later to the day. But my son, who was never mentioned in the dream, was not in the vehicle. So I thought that was interesting.
Yeah.
And the 11th, if you look into the numbers and the meaning of numbers like 11 and 13 and things like that, 13 generally means rebellion or rebellion against God. 11 means chaos, disorder, and judgment. So that's why you have dates like 9/11 and other dates that 11 is important. 11 was important in my case because I had the dream on the 11th, and the month later, the accident on the 11th. So, I mean, that's pretty much it. You know, the dream never gave me any kind of indication as to dates anything would happen or anything like that. It wasn't that specific. I just thought it was interesting that someone was typing to me, and I was hearing it in my brain.
Yeah.
And I was gauging it as a threat. But the main thing is, I wasn't going to let anything that someone said to me in a dream or anywhere else intimidate me and keep me from saying what I want to say, using my American right as an American citizen to use the First Amendment free speech. I wasn't going to stop doing that. So that was the main thing really for me.
Yeah. Thank you. That's incredible. I mean, it's an example of a lot of different things that all of us can learn from. I'm really sorry about the dog experience. I know exactly what that's, I mean, pretty much what that's like. I've been through it recently, losing a small dog, you know, in my family. It's a family member, and dogs have a lot of qualities that humans could really emulate and learn a lot from. Their degree of devotion, unswerving devotion, and, you know, they're, I mean, just amazing creatures, I think. And I never think of various kinds of animals as lower than us necessarily, because in some ways they're always showing us things that we need to aspire to, and it's just amazing. So
it was, and my dog, I almost got the sense in the dream that the dog was part of the threat, if that makes sense. My dog was, I was very close to my dog. She followed me everywhere. I called her my assistant engineer. She was with me all the time. She always went on rides with me. She always went everywhere. And she was the one that paid with her life.
Right. Amazing. Which dogs often do that voluntarily to save their owners.
Yeah.
I mean, there's all kinds of stories about that.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, whatever happened, the main thing to me was that my daughter was fine, and she was.
Yeah.
And that I'm going to be fine, and I can work through this. It's going to take me a while to get fully recovered, but I will be back 100% hopefully to where I was before. That's the main thing.
Yeah, that's exciting, and I think that's also a sign to us, you know, that one way to interpret it is that it might be difficult, but if you have determination to stick with what's true, no matter what, then you will, one way or the other, get through it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And you'll end up in good shape and very, very strong in the end.
Yeah, absolutely.
So it's, you know, fear is about as useful as chemical fertilizer, maybe less.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I can't think of anything it's good for. Because whatever you think you might be able to do by fear of something bad, you can do much better by love of something good.
Mm-hmm.
And even if you're talking about being in a situation where you have to physically fight or use lethal force, which hopefully we won't get to, what's in your mind and your intent while you're doing that makes a huge difference in the outcome, and especially the impact on you. And if you're fighting out of hatred of what's bad, it's not the same experience as fighting out of love of what's good.
Yeah, that's very true. I tried to use that same idea in the recuperation and recovery process.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah.
And on a biological level, since, you know, this little experience with these unfriendly people using that electronic transmission to get into you, every one of our cells, we're going to find out, are transmitting back and forth to us, who are the person living in the body, and they respond instantly to our feelings of dread or anger or fear or frustration or happiness and optimism. And when you're optimistic, it's already been measured. It affects your acidity in your body, your blood chemistry, everything else. They just, every one of these individual cells just believes you. And if you are transmitting to them that things are good and that we're going to come out fine, then they respond in kind.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah,
I think that's part of the
same thing
to immunity. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right. I mean, and I think hormones, what science in its current primitive form calls hormones, which are very powerful in the body and have a lot to do with how you age, your energy level and all that, are instantly affected by your emotional state and vice versa.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, makes sense to me.
So, well, I'm really grateful that we don't have to communicate between dimensions at this point. You can still be here and, you know, be part of what we're doing physically. And we still have time and we still have a chance. And every day that we're still here, there's still unlimited opportunity for what we can do to make things better.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, thank you for letting me share that.
Yeah, I really appreciate it very much. It's super inspiring. And I mean, all of us can hopefully look at what we're going through now and employ a similar attitude and say, you know, thanks for the opportunity, because without the adversity, it's not like I would like that for anybody, but adversity hides opportunity. Because it's in the midst of stress that you have a chance to really learn things that you can't do by just imagining them.
Yeah.
But if you're not in the midst of severe adversity at the moment, that's great. You know, appreciate the preparation time. And I remember reading, I was really involved in martial arts for a long time and still am in some ways. And I remember a book by one of the great Japanese martial arts masters. And it was like a small, a brief, like a haiku verse almost. And it said, laugh in the dojo, cry on the battlefield. Cry in the dojo, laugh in the battlefield. And it was like our choice. You know, if we really challenge ourselves when things are easier or when we're in normal life, and we push, you know, like we didn't have unlimited time and we really need to value the opportunities we have and use every one of them. Don't think that you're going to wait for some opportunity later. And you teach yourself and you find out what are you missing, and really try to learn everything that you can now. Then on the battlefield later, in other words, when things get really demanding and you're tested, whatever attitude you had in your training is what will come out.
Yeah. Yeah, it makes perfect sense.
So, mm-hmm. All right. Well, let me see if there was anything else that I really didn't get to. We talked about agriculture and the way that it's the same as medicine and how they both need to be turned around. The basic principles of real health have been taught for thousands and thousands of years. That's why we've got the Essene Gospel of Peace posted on our website, because it's a little bit archaic in some ways in terms of context, but it's the same principles that if they were understood now would make about 99% of medical care, not 100 because you need it in situations like Doug just went through, but about 99% of it dealing with health and all that would become irrelevant if we just relearn the basic laws of nature that is like the owner's manual for the physical body, because it's designed to stay in good shape from before you're born until when you leave. And we can have that back. And it's a good idea actually to learn about it now, because the environment is so unfriendly in terms of the chemtrail activities and EMF. Oh, I did want to mention something about EMF for all the people who are involved in smart meters and the dangers of cell phones and Wi-Fi. And I get reminded of this, you know, when I'm have a little bit of time to exercise in the gym or something, and I see women sticking their cell phones, smartphones in their bras while they're working out, or men sticking it in their pockets. And it's just because they don't understand. The smartphone or the cell phone, even the flip phone that preceded the smartphone, these are radiation devices. These are not just friendly little technologies to make your life nice. They have been designed not intentionally by the technicians in the, you know, factories and stuff, but by the people who planned how to use this technology. They were intentionally designed to hurt you. And I know it's going to sound weird and a lot of people won't believe me and think that I'm a crazy conspiracy theorist and all this, but no, it's actually true that they could as easily have come up with technologies that were health enhancing while they let you communicate through a telephone. But instead of that, they're trying to replace all the hard lines on telephones now with cell phones that emit RF frequency that has been shown to cause not just cancer, which is a good marker, but all kinds of other problems as well. And so they're proliferating them instead of warning people. And you never want to carry those on your body. Any way that you can possibly avoid it, you need to do it. Don't put your laptop on your lap, in spite of the name that encourages you to do that. Never do it. Don't have Wi-Fi in your house. If you do, get rid of it. Again, I'm not giving you medical advice, okay? Forget that, but because that's not legal anyway in this country. But I'm just giving you my experience, which you can reject or explore as you feel like doing. And if you have Wi-Fi in your house, get rid of it. We have a friend named Paul Harding who's probably going to, he's been on the show once before. He tests for damaging radiation inside your house. He's really good. He's in Arizona. And we had him on, I think, sometime around when we had Barry Troer, who is the expert in electronic warfare for the UK government. And he's one of these great true scientists that defected from the work he was doing of hurting people and you know, exploring how to hurt them worse in weaponry using EMF, to turning around and saying, wait a minute, isn't that the technology that was put into cell phones, smart meters, Wi-Fi for computers and everything, and cell towers and all this stuff? And he said, well, yeah, it actually is. And it's being proliferated all over the world now more and more. And I personally recently ran into that because a church near where I live put a disguised cell tower on their property right where they have Sunday school, all the kids' classes, and all the community groups that meet there and everything. You know, they actually put a cell tower a few feet away from where all these people meet every week. And it was just amazing. I mean, the fact that somebody recites spiritual teachings does not mean that they're actually caring anything about what happens to humanity or even themselves, obviously. So I did go over to that church and talk to them in a very nice way and said, you know, you guys may not know. I was only talking to the people in the office, and they weren't in charge of policy or anything. But I gave them the archives of Barry Troer's talks on Lost Arts Radio, which I highly recommend for your educational input if you haven't already heard them. There's three of them. You can see them on YouTube anytime you want. And these are all harmful radiations. So you can hardwire your computers, which is what Barry said to do, and just run a cable to it. It's really not that complex. But if you have a smart meter on your house, you have to get rid of it if you possibly can. And I think everywhere in the country, it's still legal to have them removed once you figure out what they were able to put on your house. And I recommend doing that. And then even if you're in an apartment and you've got a bank of smart meters on the other side of a wall, which causes a lot of damage and magnifies it because of the number of them, there are ways that I found out that you can put aluminum sheeting on the inside of the wall where the smart meters are and block and bounce off the radiation. You have to be really careful and do it correctly with somebody who's an expert in that so that you don't end up bouncing this harmful radiation around inside your house. But there are ways to do that. And then, you know, if you have a chance, move obviously to a place where they don't have that. Barry Troer himself in the UK doesn't have a computer, doesn't have a smart meter, doesn't have anything that gives off radiation like that. All he has is an old-fashioned landline telephone, and we had to do our interviews with him over that. So pretty interesting, but he's a great person, and I think you might enjoy that. So they're putting in more and more and more cell towers in even small towns all across the country, probably, unfortunately, even out in the country when people manage to get a place to live and they escape from the city or the town. And they're disguising them to look like trees, or the one that I found in the church near us, it was made to look like a fake light post. And, you know, most people would never think twice about looking at it and thinking it was something normal. But it's not normal. So it's one of those things that I wanted to write a letter to the editor of the local newspaper. I had already tried, though, writing them about chemtrails on a day when we had 20 jets in the sky at one time spraying toxic metal and other garbage on us. And the newspaper would not print it because they had somebody totally brainwashed for their editor. He was perfect for the job. And he said, if it's not acknowledged by government agencies, how do you know if it's true? In other words, you can be looking at something right in front of your face, and if the government doesn't tell you, yes, it's true, then you know not to believe it. This is completely insane. And it's the a tribute to the expertise of the modern educational systems that are in place that are even getting into private school now. And more than that, even to the media and television, where you have all of these kind of condescending, nice-looking, sometimes uniformed scientists and other experts telling you what to believe and not believe. And most people actually go with that because it's too threatening psychologically to think that all of these other things, you know, could be true, and it could be that far out of control, which unfortunately is how it is. So I found another alternative newspaper in our area, and you might find some of these in your own town, that is actually willing to print whatever you write in a letter to the editor. I went ahead and sent in the chemtrail letter, which I think we have posted somewhere on our lostartsradio.com site. And then also, I'm probably this week going to write to them about the cell towers, and it may not really make the church and the elementary school managers that happy, but I'm going to encourage people to ask their church, ask their temple or synagogue or any religious gathering place, or ask their elementary or high school, are you guys getting paid to have a disguised cell tower on your property? It's not really an unfair question, because apparently these are being put in absolutely everywhere, not because the cell signals are not strong enough, but for other reasons for which they want as many cell towers as close together as possible. It's really not a very positive sign, but it is what's happening. And Doug just let me know, thank you, Doug, that the letter to the editor that got rejected, and that they wouldn't, is it the one they wouldn't print? I don't know. Which one is it, Doug? Is it the one that did get printed? I think it's the one that did get printed, and it's part of a weekly focus that was written. That's the article that we try to get out every week. Yeah, it's the one that was written, actually. And I may get a chance to post the one that got rejected, too. It was kind of a satire, thanking them for the great sunsets from all the toxic metal they were putting in the air. So if you get a chance and you find that you have a newspaper that will actually print what you write in a letter to the editor, it's one way to get some of those ideas out, so that you might reach people that are wondering about if some of those things could be true. So let me see. I should mention the call-in number again. What we're doing on this experimental show is we're stopping early if people don't call enough until more people know that we exist here. So if you're interested in the show, tell other people that it's here. And the call-in number is 657-383-1002. 657-383-1002. And I had a couple more things to go over, but John's been waiting a while from Dallas, and wanted to just say hi to him and see what he's got in mind. Hi, John. How are you doing today?
Good morning. How are you?
I'm doing great. Nice to hear from you.
Excellent. Thank you. Great show. And I wanted to thank Doug for sharing his story.
Yeah, me too. Thanks. I think that was great.
I had a question on which archive guests I might want to look up, because where I live in the country, I moved. One of the reasons I moved here was because there are no cell towers, and even the basically it's just a flat landscape. It's not developed. But then the problem was there are no landlines for telephones. There are basically very limited resource for internet. So unfortunately, I do use Wi-Fi for the internet access, and I do have a cell phone now. I didn't have one before, but I have to have one because we don't have any landlines. I was wondering if there were any particular guests that might have information and alternatives on what I can do to basically reduce the effects of EMF pollution while I'm in this situation.
Yeah, well, I mean, definitely listen to all three interviews with Barry Troer, which are on YouTube. You can easily look those up by just putting his name and Lost Arts Radio. But and we probably are going to have him back. And also Doug, I mean, not Doug, but... the name will come back to me. It's the other man who does, Paul Harding, sorry, and from Arizona. He's very good, and I think we had him on. And the other thing I wanted to ask you is, why can't you get a satellite and then have it hardwired from the satellite receiver to your computer?
Oh, I don't know. I'm not really familiar with that technology, so that is a possibility.
Yeah, I'm almost positive that you can do that. And what you do is you get any of the big... satellite companies, and they will put a little receiver on your roof, probably. And that's just like a really small dish. It might be about 2 or 3 inches in size. And then they run a hard line from that. And normally, what they're going to encourage you to do is run it down to a router inside your house, and the router puts out Wi-Fi.
Right.
So you have a router right now?
Yes, we do. Yes, we do.
Okay, how is that router getting its signal?
My older brother handles most of the techie at the family.
Okay, well, find out about that, and then what you do is you replace that router with what's called a wired router. You can do that right away as soon as you want to.
Okay.
And what that means is that the kind of router that you get does not put out any radiation. It's not a hybrid. It doesn't put out Wi-Fi and the hard line connections. It just, or if it does, it's better to get one that can just put out, is just a place where you can hook in cables. And then you run those to the locations in your house where you want to have the computer.
Excellent.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. I'm sure my brother, once I tell him, he can figure out the exact details, but yeah, it makes sense what you're saying.
Yeah, it's easy and it's cheap and it's quick. And it just means you're going to have some wires in your house, but it doesn't look that bad. And if you want to put them like where the ceiling meets the wall or something, they don't look bad at all. And Doug mentioned that Paul Harding was on our show on 3/14/15, show number 10, real early show. And also, Doug says that he would put a YouTube playlist link for Barry Troer in the chat room that we're running right now. So if you have a computer that can look at the chat room on Blog Talk Radio, then you would see that link. But yeah, the hardwired router thing is really easy and quick, and they need to be doing that in schools all over the country, because they're really compromising the health of all the kids by this huge push to put in Wi-Fi everywhere as if it was some kind of a big advanced thing.
And it's not that expensive. It doesn't sound like it's going to be an extra expense for schools or for even private use.
You mean to put in the wires?
Yeah, it sounds like it's pretty fair.
No, it's
simple,
easy.
Right?
It's really simple and easy. You know, it's just propaganda that this has to be done with Wi-Fi. I don't know of any legitimate need for Wi-Fi. I mean, if you go to a Starbucks or something and you want to eat GMO coffee, then you want to sit outside where there's no wires. But if they were aware of the health implications and they wanted to help their customers, which, you know, could be one step closer to happening if the customers would mention it to them, then what they need to do is have a router out in the coffee table area and wires running from that to each table. And then when you go there, you just plug in. And I don't know if the new tablets and stuff have a way to plug into a wire. Some of them may be only Wi-Fi, but if they are, I would suggest don't buy them.
Would it be like a separate type of, like, instead of a USB port, it would be like a specific port for the hardwire?
Yeah, it's the same kind of port that your basic signal comes into from the wall. It's like what they call an Ethernet cable. And Doug, who knows way more than I do about this kind of stuff, is that the tablets, some of the new tablets, are Wi-Fi only. And so my suggestion is do not buy them. And I just can't think of any absolute reason to get them, because the electrical system of the body is so delicate that Wi-Fi radiation is really harmful over time. You don't fall over the first minute usually, but in 10 years you might get diagnosed with advanced cancer that's moving really fast, and the doctor says, well, there's no reason. You just have the genetics for it, or, you know, it's just bad luck. Or eventually the medical system may admit that a lot of cancer is viral. And they know this now beyond a shadow of a doubt. And in fact, they know that in the polio vaccine, there's at least one really well-known cancer-causing virus that was contaminating millions and millions of polio vaccines, and they went ahead and used them anyway.
Wow.
So, you know, there's a few things they're not wanting to tell you.
Would the guests you have on tomorrow night, when they're going to be discussing energetics and energetic healing for the body, would they probably have also some information regarding...
You can't call into that show, though.
Oh, yeah, but, yeah. No, I was wondering if they'll be able to discuss... some ways that people can use this information on energy healing to begin, like in Doug's case, to, you know, help the body to speed the healing process rather than just rely
on it. Well, it's probably just going to be a very beginning explanation, you know, when General Burt will mention it. And then we're going to have him back for more detail. And I'm just, as of this morning, suggesting that they come back and do a show on encouraging defection in high levels of the power structure. This is probably not going to make our show enamored of the rulers, to say the least. But I think, you know, we just need to go for it at this point, because even though everything in a way seems fine, we don't know how much time we actually have left. And we want to look back at the end of our lives, since we are leaving anyway. We want to be able to look back when we're leaving and feel as good as possible about what we did. And so, you know, every one of us needs to keep pushing the envelope and see what we can add to what we're already involved in, or how we can do what we're doing in a better way. But yeah, we'll get into as much as we can with them. It's amazing to even have General Burt on at all. I think he's in his mid-80s now, mid or late 80s. And he was one of the really most influential generals during the Cold War, and maybe in one of the very top positions in all the intelligence for the European continent and possibly more. I mean, he was really high in the power structure. And so he's probably going to share a little bit, at least, about how it's possible not to realize that you're serving destruction, and how what got him to change. But he's an example. of a defector from high up in the power structure and what they can do. And Dr. Rima Labo is an example of what a medical doctor within the power structure can do if they, you know, throw away the drugs, excuse me, and start telling people what's really going on and what their real options are. And their other trustee that's not available for tomorrow, but we'll have back Ralph Fusitola as a great attorney that has been mainly focused on keeping supplements legally available and stuff like that. And he's an example of what somebody from inside the law structure can do that's mostly being used against us, but it could reverse. And I just, you know, I'd like to see more of that happening.
Well, they sound like they're great guests, so I'll be looking forward to the show.
Yeah, it's incredible. So if you know anybody that might like to hear them, let them know. It's a really unusual opportunity.
I've been sharing the links to the website to my friends and family, and basically it's fantastic. I really appreciate all the work that you and Doug do.
Oh, sure. Yeah, I'm still at the point of waiting to see if enough people are getting anything from this, you know, call-in part of the show. I'd like to keep it going, but we need to find ways to reach more people. And I know one of the listeners before said, well, one way she could help us is to call in and request that I get interviewed on other people's shows. So the first one of the, yeah, it was a really good idea. And I need to make myself available for that. So I'm learning to go more and more completely against what my natural inclination is of being invisible and just be completely out there. And so that interview went really well, and that radio station is considering live streaming our Saturday show on their network. So if a few things like that happen, then, you know, we'd really be able to start reaching people.
Well, that's how I discovered you and your work, was when you were a guest on another show.
Okay. And, Was it one radio network? That's the one I'm talking about, actually. So if you feel like it, you know what would really help, since they have not made a decision yet on whether to live stream this Q&A show? Mm-hmm. If you have any way to contact them, ask them if they'd please do that.
Yeah, because if you can contact them, so I'll send them an email.
Yeah, if you can do it, if you have time, I think that might push them, you know, to actually do it. And that we'd reach, I think they have a pretty big audience, so that we'd probably reach a lot more people that way.
Yeah, and again, thankfully, when I was listening that day, you were a guest, so it led me to find this website.
Exactly, it was really good timing, and if we could come through their network every week, it would be really good, because we're pretty small right now.
Well, I'll send them an email.
Okay, great, and let us know what happens with the new hardwired setup. I think that's kind of exciting that you can do that.
It is, very much. I really appreciate all the information that both of you are sharing, so have a good weekend, and thanks again.
Okay, talk to you later, John. Thanks.
Right. Take care. Yeah. Bye-bye.
Okay, so now before I start going off on something about the next subject, let's talk to Dee and see what's happening with her. Good morning, Dee. You're calling from California, right?
Yeah, good morning.
Good morning.
I just wanted to let you know a few things. I've been in excruciating pain lately, but that mm-hmm. was because of something that I bought from an herb company on the West Coast. They had put something in the bulk herb that they were selling, and it was labeled as such, but I didn't realize that because I bought it through a health store.
Mm-hmm.
But after this happened, it affected my my eye. I'm in it, like, really a lot of pain, so much.
Wow.
So it's actually nauseating, but I'm trying to deal with it with some homeopathic eye drops. But I wanted to warn people that there seems to be a lack of good sourcing of herbal, where the herb companies are buying their herbs from across to other countries.
We have okay.
to be aware that they are adding silicon dioxide to herbs.
Right, I've heard of that.
basically sand, I think, but it could be more than that. But mm-hmm. It had a horrible effect on my gut and then into my brain. My brain's been, like, on fire from it. But I just wanted to warn people, ask all the time. So I called the herb company and I asked them how many of their herbs they were putting this into, and they said just two or three. So
that's funny.
And I explained to them nicely that I thought that they had to be more careful on their sourcing of their product, because that's exactly why we use those herb companies, is because we trust them to not be using these anti-taking agents or these flow agents into the herb, the bulk herb.
Yeah, exactly. There's several of those used in supplements in general, too.
They're highly dangerous, and so if we can remember not only to read the labels, but to question everything, even if you're getting it through a second party, question it and see if they've, you know, addressed that.
Yeah. Yeah. You want to tell us what herb company you're using?
Well, it's a big one on the West Coast, and I kind of don't want to make
any... Okay, you don't have to.
But, yeah, just be careful.
Yeah, exactly. It's good that they at least listed it if people know what to look for. I mean, ideally, if you want to use an herb, you should use it by itself. I mean, without additives in it, right?
Well, that's what I thought I was getting, but...
Yeah, I know. I'm not saying it was your fault. It's just that these companies that put it together with other things, that they need to definitely warn their customers or ideally not use the additives in them.
Well, I've noticed a trend lately that a lot of the smaller herb companies are getting bought out by Big Pharma, but without letting people know what's happening. And so they're sort of sneaking this stuff in there. And I don't know if it's the case with that particular herb company, but when I called them, it was like I was talking to a little kid. They don't really understand what's going on. They aren't wise to it. So it's like I had to look at it instead of in anger, but with, you know, empathy, because these are like little children that just don't know what's going on. So
I think sometimes companies hire people who have no idea, you know, for that reason.
Right.
Because they won't have to give out any bad information. You know, if the people don't know what to say, I've run into the same thing with politicians. Most of them have staff that don't know about any of the issues. They have no understanding of anything. And they're just trained to say, I'll let the representative know right away.
Yes.
And then they just probably throw away all the comments.
Right. But on another note of good intent, I used to get really upset when I would get all these phone calls from other countries. People that didn't speak very good English would call me all the time and try to tell me that they were Microsoft and that I had a computer problem and this and that. And really make me mad. And I would ask them to not call me anymore, and they were still calling me, and it would just ruin my day. So since I've had a reset of my thinking, thanks to you, I am now in the process of wishing them well instead of becoming angry at me, and it's really
amazing. So what happens when you do that?
Well, I feel better. For one thing, I had a little girl from China call me the other day, and I didn't really have a chance to explain things to her, but I prayed for her to understand what she's doing. But before that, the people that were really harassing me, I finally said, I know who you are, and I know that you're scamming me. And I said it really politely. I said, I really don't appreciate it, but it's you're harming yourself more than you're harming me. And I explained to him about who, you know, take a look at what you're doing. You're harassing people for a living. That's not a really good
idea. Yeah.
And after
go ahead.
I was just going to say, after I explained it to him, the phone call stopped.
Wow. Wow, amazing. So this is like it's like a martial arts example, right? That
yeah.
It's like kind of an Aikido type image.
I mean, the phone calls were for 2 years straight, and I couldn't get them to stop calling until I did that. Once I changed it from being angry to really praying for him and pointing out that he's endangering himself, it just made a whole difference.
Wow. He decided to take you off the list, apparently.
Yeah.
Wow. That's incredible.
I thought so. I mean, it's sure helping me to not have to deal with that. But now it was a lesson. So now every time somebody's stirring my coals of anger, I immediately change it around in my mind to pray for them and wish them well and wish them recognition of their situation. And it's
yeah.
just powerful.
I want to come back to that, but I wanted to mention, I was trying to think of an herb company that I had some good experience with before, and one of them was called Mountain Rose Herbs. Are you familiar with them?
That's the one that's putting the silicon dioxide in.
Okay, well, they probably don't know, because I've talked to a lot of their management people. I mean, they do know that it's there, but they don't know that it's necessarily going to cause any harm. The ones that I've talked to have been really well-intentioned over there and trying to do a good job. And they do some heavy metal testing on their herbs. They will send you the lab reports on them if you ask. And they admit it's not, you know, completely perfect and clean, but I think they're trying. I've had some good experience with them, and they probably think that silicon dioxide, which this people have told them, is basically sand, which is a natural product.
Yeah, I think they have good intent. I don't know that they're doing it purposefully, but there may be somebody in their purchasing department that's really naive or something like that.
Yeah. What I finally came to with herbs is that the fresh ones are the best. And that was just my experience, because you can use them without any additives. And things like aloe vera and ginger and curcumin and stuff that you can get fresh, and, you know, certain kinds of mushrooms, if they have a good effect on your body, then rather than get them in a pill, if you can eat them in a fresh form, then you don't have any of those issues at all. Nobody's going to put anything in them if they're organic.
Right. And that, I wanted to tell you, I have a tonic that I make out of apple cider vinegar.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm using it to kind of make my own, well, it's a tonic, but you can use it for anything, but I wanted to tell you the recipe. It's just apple cider vinegar that has the mother in it, you know, basically it's...
Yeah.
Bragg's is one brand that, but other co-ops have different ones, but...
Yeah.
I fill the... like a gallon jar, half full of that, and then half is just fresh things like onions, garlic, ginger, horseradish, and hot peppers, or even sweet peppers, but peppers.
Mm-hmm.
And then I added to that an herb that I researched to try to find something that would help with my immune system issue, and that is mustard.
Wow.
Yeah, so mustard seeds ground I put in there, and it's really a powerful tonic. You can just
What do you do with this stuff?
Well, you stir it in the apple cider vinegar after you've chopped it all up, and then you take, like, you strain it after a while, like it could be days, weeks, months, it doesn't really matter.
Yeah.
And you just take it, and you can use it for salad dressing. You can mix it with, like, olive oil for salad dressing. It's just delicious.
Mm-hmm.
Or you can just, like, a teaspoon in a glass of water. But it's very potent and very healing.
Wow. Yeah, this is what I'm talking about for herbs, because I used to use a lot of powdered herbs. I got them mostly from Mountain Rose and a few other places where they were organic, and they were as good as I could find, but probably not perfect because they go through a lot of hands and you don't know the manufacturing exactly. And finally, I really got the feeling like my body would be a lot happier with just using them fresh, and things that would grow in the local area would be ideal. So I got more into looking at the effects of the ones that you're talking about putting together, because those were the ones that were available. And the effect was far, far better than with dried powder.
Right. I'm not against dried powder either, but I like that tonic a lot. And then
yeah. The
other thing that I've been doing is cultures. Like, mm-hmm. I make bowls with just little baby cucumbers packed in a jar, and then you put a little bit of brine, which is just sea salt and dissolved in water.
Yeah.
But I also put pickling spices and maybe a hot pepper or some chopped up onion or something, garlic in there, and then put a grape leaf on top, and then it just mm-hmm. makes it own cultured pickles. They're not the bad for you kind of pickles that have vinegar. That's not mm-hmm. the mother, but it's just, it makes its own culture. And the pickle juice from those pickles is the most healing thing for the gut that there really is. So I've been using that a lot lately just to try to get through this terrible problem.
Yeah. The pain that you were talking about from the silicone dioxide, that's over now, right? You're through that.
Oh no, I'm even nauseous from the pain.
You're still in it. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So you stopped taking in silicone dioxide and you're using these other things to help it.
Well, I'm trying to help it. Yeah, I finally got some homeopathic eye drops. They help a little bit, but they're not as potent as they used to be. I talked to a biological dentist.
Uh-huh.
And they source it from Germany, and it's from Sanum in Germany, and it used to be called Pleomuke, and it was the only I've had this before, and it was the only eye drop that really helped. But she said they're having a hard time getting any of those homeopathics from Germany now. Germany's really changed. It's kind of going communist, and they're really attacking the homeopathy.
Yeah, the German government is completely insane at this point, and most of the higher levels of it. Obviously trying to destroy the country in favor of world government. But a lot of the European countries are taken over by that kind of thing right now. But I was just going to tell you, if you're, and again, I'm not telling you anything to do, no medical advice or anything like that, but I'm thinking if I was looking at this happening to me and I was having eye pain, which I think you're talking about, right?
And yeah, what it is it's called, it's got several names. Uveitis is one of them. Iriditis, it's where the lens of the eye sticks to the iris. It makes the pupil look really in funny shapes. It won't dilate back. And it's like stabbing hot needles in my eye.
How did you connect it to the silicon dioxide?
Well, after I took I bought some aloe that had it in it, and I was working on healing my leaky gut with the aloe, but since I had...
You're talking about dry powdered aloe, right?
Yeah. But
okay.
It was tape aloe, not aloe vera.
Okay.
It's a bitter herb that's supposed to really help your leaky gut, and I have that issue. So instead of helping my leaky gut, it just made my whole gut reset, and it just freaked out my whole intestines. And my brain through the gut-brain axis.
Mm-hmm.
And it happened to me before in the past.
Okay, well, all the things you were talking about with the good cultures and all that, which also are a primary benefit of raw milk in my experience, because it turns into a kind of yogurt in your stomach with the hydrochloric acid, or you can, ferment it first. But what I've found to be really helpful, and I'm not telling anybody else to do this, is to clean out the gut immediately first you know, by at least a short time of fasting and absolutely body temperature water enemas. Right. Because if there's any toxic material circulating in the blood, you know, that in my experience causing headaches or eye stuff or certain kinds of blood poisoning will actually cause blurred vision, any of that stuff, the first thing to do is get garbage out of the gut. Not by a gradual process, but by washing it out with water immediately. And at that point, replace it with the good cultured stuff and organic live food, you know, fresh stuff that your body reacts well to. And the raw milk being the best source of the cultures that I found, but these other ones are good too. And at that point, you could get a lot reduced time of suffering from what you're dealing with.
Yeah, I think I will be. It'll be shorter than before. I lasted like 2 weeks of excruciating pain, but I'm already almost a week long of it already, and you get kind of put up with it. But I did that, and every time I try to eat, if it's just apples or oranges, or I'm sort of sticking to like what you said, the cultured milk and the pickle juice, because every time food in my colon, it's just excruciating for my eye. So maybe I totally not eat anything for a while, I'm thinking.
Yeah, you might need to fast for a while. You know, read through the Essene Gospel again if you haven't seen it before.
I'm trying to figure out where it is online.
LostHeartsRadio.com. Okay. And what you need to do to see the written PDF of it directly, just go to a search engine. Like, I don't like to use Google, but I was using StartPage. Now I'm using this one that seems better called DuckDuckGo, which does not spy on you or take any data or do anything like that. And it has no connection to Google, which StartPage does. And in that search engine, you type in Essene Gospel of Peace, Volume 1, PDF.
Okay.
And if you do that exactly, it'll take you right to it. And that just reminds you that for the last many thousands of years, no matter what kind of toxin is in your body, even though we've got new ones now that they didn't have back then, the same system works.
Right.
And it's really amazing, you know, that it's amazing that we could forget it, but we're so detached from nature in the current, you know, state of society that it helps to get reminders all the time. Your body strives toward natural and harmony and healing automatically. So if you get out of its way, which fasting is, then you know, that just happens much, much more easily. And for me, I would never do fasting or anything like it without the water enemas.
Yeah, I do enemas. And I've been doing them all day long. If any food is in there, it is painful. But
yeah, so that's giving you a clue. Just don't, you know. And again, I have to stop myself. I keep wanting to say, do this or don't do that. I can't say anything like that. If we move to a country where there's free speech sometime, we can do it. But for the moment, I would just say, that's what I would certainly think of doing for myself is, you know, your body's just screaming at you. You know, if my body is screaming at me, don't eat, then I'd try not to eat.
Yeah, so I'm going to look at it as a blessing because I wanted to reset my colon anyway. So I'm
going
to look at it as an opportunity to do that
and
get through it, basically.
The tissue in the digestive tract turns over very fast and heals fast, but you have to allow it.
But I have the retrovirus problem that you were talking, what you're alluding to with the polio vaccine, and it's very
problematic
because those viruses, I've actually physically observed them moving from one part to another. Like if I can get them to leave the gut area, they will go directly into the brain area. And if I can get them to leave the brain area, they'll go right down my spine into my nervous system. So I have to chase them around.
You know, Marcus Rothkranz, another thing that's really inspiring and useful to read, except he doesn't know about raw milk. A lot of vegans think raw milk is evil. But aside from that issue, his book, Heal Yourself 101, is incredible. I mean, there's no way to get it free that I know of, but it's worth $30. And it's sold on either his website, healanything.com, or which is a great website, by the way. You might really like that, healanything.com, and or on Amazon. And the book is called Heal Yourself 101. And basically his protocol is water fasting first for whatever time you can. And then when you can't do that anymore, you go to vegetable juice fasting, not fruit, because when you're healing like that, you don't want the sugar, even fruit sugar. And after you do vegetable juices, then you start on, you know, what he uses is blended raw live food, and then back to an improved normal diet. And he's had people all over the world that have cured almost everything with that protocol. And there was another, I'm talking fast here because we may wrap it up at 10 this morning, but because I've got another appointment to get ready for. But what the same principle was used by a guy named Rudolf Bruce, Bruess. And this is another great book that I would recommend. It's cheap and it's on Amazon, and it's called The Bruce Cancer Cure. And all he did is basically put people on a very small amount of vegetable juice for 6 weeks with no food. And he found that he had to even strain the juice. That it was important that there was no solid in the juice even. And he reported 90-some percent cure of serious cancer cases.
Wow. That sounds really good.
It's exciting. I mean, you might really like reading it, and it applies to so many things. The body doesn't have a separate system for curing a certain disease. It just begins to cure everything when you allow it to.
Right. Well, the culture, the way I cultured the raw oat milk is, I don't think it's harming the milk at all, and I don't have very good digestive enzymes to...
Yeah, so maybe that makes it easier to digest, huh?
Yeah, but I mean, if you have one more minute, I'll tell you how I do it.
Sure, I'd like to hear.
Okay, well, I put a gallon of the milk into several quart glass canning jars, but not all the way to the top. I leave like a couple inches, a few inches.
Okay.
Even. So it has room to expand. And then instead of putting a mason lid on it, I just gently set round glass discs just so nothing will get in. But if it wants to have air come out, it can do that.
Yeah, during the fermentation, that would probably happen.
Right. So first, it takes like 8 hours for it to just settle out. I don't do anything. I just leave it in a box like that, just no or anything. I just let it kind of just get to room temperature.
Yeah.
Then I put on a really low, low heat to where it's not over 80 degrees. It's between
Fahrenheit.
70 to 80 Fahrenheit. And I have a fish thermometer in there, and I just use a little tiny coffee cup hot plate thing and just stick it on low and put it in there, and it stays right about 75.
Okay.
Once I feel that the milk in the outside of the jar is, you know, just barely warm, I will take a little bit of water and good water, maybe an eighth of a cup, in two different glasses. And in one glass, I put some culture in there, like Danica or whatever. They have different cultures you can get online. And then not very much, just like a little eighth of a teaspoon in the water, and let it sit for 30 seconds or so, and then stir it. And then I pour that evenly into the jars, the quart jars. There's usually like four. And then I stir that with a plastic spoon, not metal, and then I take the other glass with about an eighth of a cup of water, and I put in two drops of vegetable rennet, which you can get on, and then I do the same with that. I pour put that evenly into the jars and stir it and put their little discs on top and close the box and leave it there for about 12 hours. And it just turns into this fluffy, spreadable, really palatable, almost like a cream cheese.
Wow. How neat. And then it's just kind of a good sour taste to it, right?
Yeah, it's actually quite good. It tastes like yogurt, and it's a little thicker than yogurt, but it's just full of good stuff, and it doesn't destroy the raw good things in the milk because it's never eaten.
No, 80 degrees is nothing, so that's great. That's like a little below body temperature.
So I think, you know, if somebody wanted to try, like, some other cultures that are particular for particular things, they could do it that way instead of following the advice on the label that says to heat it to boiling and this and that. I would just throw those recipes out and do it the more natural way.
Well, yeah, what they're saying is that you have to kill all competing bacteria to let the bacteria in the culture do anything or it won't work.
Yeah, so I just throw out their advice and do it this way, and it works fine.
Wow. And you're saying it comes out with a fairly solid consistency?
Yeah, you get halfway and half cheese, and then you just put a cloth, like a cheesecloth, over with a rubber band over a bowl, and then you just pour it out and let it drain through the cloth for a little bit, and then just
okay.
Put it in the... And you can use the whey. The whey is really... It's like almost a fizzling, sparkling whey, which is really interesting.
So it's a good drink by itself.
Uh-huh. Or you can flavor it with berries or maple or whatever.
Wow, neat. Yeah, if you wanted to write that down so that, you know, people that don't necessarily hear it right now, we'd put it on the website for people to see.
Okay, will do.
Yeah, just send it in to the... email address richard@lostartsradio.com and we'll share it with everybody. Sounds really worthwhile to know about.
Well, thank you, Richard. I won't take up any more time, but I really, really love the show and I hope that everything keeps going and works out. So thank you.
Yeah, I'm sure it will. And I hope you start feeling better immediately.
Thank you.
Let us know how it goes.
Your advice and not anything solid at all in there for a while.
Yeah, your body is trying to nicely tell you something there.
Yeah, listen to my body is what I say.
It's fairly smart.
It seems to be.
And also, thanks for your story about dealing with the telephone people too.
Yeah, I mean
that was great.
It was such a miracle, and now I use it on everybody I meet, and it's totally changing my whole attitude.
Yeah, it changes things physically, mentally, emotionally, every level. I mean, it almost can make you feel after a while that every experience that's given to you in your life during the day, suddenly they're all good ones.
Yeah, it's
because
funny.
even the bad ones are good ones.
It is. It turns them around. It just automatically, and it's like the true gospel that I never really understood, and now I get it, and I love it.
Yeah, and even if you don't say anything, I mean, that intent that you're projecting toward everybody else is just going to, it changes all the communication and everything. So,
yeah.
As often as you want to tell us about your experiments with that, it'd be great, because I don't think that we can be focused on that too much. That by itself could lead to basically curing pretty much everything that's going on in the world.
It's very powerful. I know it's helping me tremendously, so I thank you again.
People wonder about how they can reach people like chemtrail pilots, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because they're supposed to be some of the most hardened individuals out there, or they could never do what they're doing. And most of them do know what they're doing. Mm-hmm. But what you're doing is not actually limited by physical distance. So if you get better and better at it, you can focus it toward anybody that you feel like. They don't have to be in your physical presence.
Right.
And it's just as powerful. You know, there are some people that can do various kinds of healing at a distance and stuff, and a lot of people don't believe it's possible, but the ones who have experienced it absolutely know that it's possible, and it's not mysterious. gets into quantum physics explanations of things, but the simple, you know, bottom line of it is that what our brain interprets as distance, that says, oh, it's really hard or impossible to do something because of a distance, that's just a belief. There's no truth to it. So once the better you get at what you're doing, you can just focus that on anybody, anywhere, and then you find you're not limited to just one. If you get really good at that, you can also, just by deciding you want to, give it very specifically to any number of other beings that you feel like it.
That is so cool. I actually used it. My daughter-in-law had a baby yesterday, and I was using it.
Oh, neat. Congratulations.
Thank you. She had a really hard time last time she had a baby, and it didn't go at all the way she wanted it to go. So this time I actually did that for her childbirth, and it worked marvelously, and she had a very much more at ease birth, and the whole experience was wonderful.
Oh, neat. Did she know that you were doing anything?
No.
Okay. All right. Yeah, so see, it doesn't matter if people think that it happened or not. You know that you can watch the effect. And you don't need anyone else to know about it. I think when you first called into the show, you were wishing that you were in a position to do more of these kind of good things.
Yeah.
And it seemed like you had to be in this specific physical situation and stuff. That none of that is true. So the amount of power that you and every other individual has that we've never connected to is literally unlimited, except by our beliefs. At what you believe is impossible will be in your life impossible. But except for that, the healing energy that people are willing to let go through them is literally unlimited. And I think that's the weak spot of the power structure that intends to destroy everything. And they, at the top level, they understand everything I'm talking about. And so the main reason why they have to speed up the vaccines and speed up, you know, the chemtrail spraying and the martial law and all this stuff is so that people don't discover what you're talking about.
Yeah, and I don't know that I'd have discovered it except for discovering Lost Arts Radio because it's really...
Well, you're becoming a center of sharing it with everybody even by not saying anything.
Right.
Because, it's quite awesome when you discover the amount that you can do that way. It doesn't mean it's either that or do some good project you're working at. It means whatever you're doing physically gets kind of infused with that energy and becomes powerful on a level that people don't even know exists.
Yeah, it's my whole base camp, my whole, you know, foundation of where I'm coming from, I'm looking at it in a whole opposite way as I used to, and everything that I always kind of doubted, didn't know if it was really possible, I'm starting to really, really see that, like you said, anything is possible.
Yeah, and I think you also find that the more you get into that, the more relaxed it is, that this is not something you do by effort and stress.
Right, and even when the horrible lessons come, or like this eye thing, it's excruciating pain, I'm not looking at it as freaking out about it. I'm just looking at solutions and learning it so I can pass it on to other people.
People misunderstand stress, and they think that there's a situation or a person around them that is causing stress, but stress is the reaction to that, not the thing itself. So in other words, your eye pain, which is really bad, you know, is not a stress. It's a, I don't know even what to call it. It's a stimulus of some kind. If you react to that by tensing up and getting really upset internally, that is the source of the stress. And so the reason that, for example, people like marijuana for cancer pain and stuff is because it artificially, with some not good after effects and side effects, does what you're doing by relaxing and focusing on these things. So that's the pain-killing effect of marijuana. But it does it by zoning out your consciousness. And it makes your consciousness dull. And that leads to other not very good effects. And especially if you... smoking anything has a terrible effect on your body. But even if you eat it, like in brownies or juice or something, the way that the THC or the psychotropic component in marijuana works to make pain easier to handle is a version, a corrupt version of what you're doing with consciousness. And if you do it clear without anything else but your own focus to do it and relaxing, all the effects are good. It gets really exciting, I think, to me, anyway.
Yeah, so I just found that I can't just ignore it and eat the way I used to eat during the pain. I have to change it up. And then I was laying in bed in the middle of the night in such excruciating pain for night after night. I mean, I had to do something, and so I just started taking your advice to lean into it and just relax into the pain, and it actually blossomed into all these vivid colors. It was very strange, but I started focusing on all the colors instead of on the pain, and it really helped a lot.
Yeah, this is the ideal of what people are hoping for when they use marijuana for that. But it's full of problems that you can't get rid of, and the way that you're describing isn't. So, I mean, if people knew about it, just what you've been talking about would revolutionize everything.
It's revolutionizing me.
So, yeah, as much as you want to come and share as your exploration goes on, that would be fun.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Okay. Have a good weekend.
Thank you.
All right. Talk to you later.
Okay, bye.
Bye. So I guess, if we don't have any, I know this is going to change, this is going to change if we get live streamed on some other networks or things, but at the moment, since nobody still knows about us, relatively speaking, I think we have the luxury of wrapping it up a little bit early and letting me get ready with a little bit more time for my next commitment, so I need to do that, but thank you for being with us. Really appreciate you very much and are sending you great wishes for good experiences during the week and good learning experience playing with some of the things that Dee, the last caller from California, was talking about so well, I thought. And it's encouraging and inspiring to me to hear people doing that because the the healing power and energy that every single being, and certainly every human, has in them is, like she was saying, literally unlimited. And you can't access it and still have bad intent. So it can't be misused by the bad guys, which is kind of a nice feature, that if they're trying to use it to, you know, be more efficient in developing new weaponized viruses or something, it doesn't work like that. The main access to this healing power that is our normal state because of where we came from, access to that is in proportion to your degree of wishing well for the rest of creation and rest of humanity. The more sincere desire in you for everybody else to be in better shape, have a better life, and have, you know, more connection to reality and all that, the more access to what Dee was talking about becomes available to you. And kind of a good way to set up the system that the guys that are using, that we want to get into this defection idea that we're working on, they're actually working against their own interest, even though they don't understand that. And if they get more into being selfish in the real way, only doing what's good for them, they would never be able to harm anyone else again. Because if you hurt someone else, in that moment you hurt yourself. even on a subtle level, even thinking condemningly of anybody, even if they supposedly deserve it, you know, in a justice sense of the word, that's harmful to yourself. So, you know, there's a lot of things written by great spiritual teachers about wishing good for the people that hurt you. And I'd say, what? The people that hurt you, they should all be killed, you know. And I really love and appreciate Alex Jones. But you can see him gradually starting to realize that if you, whatever fighting and struggle and efforts in your life you have to do, if you do them from a place of love and a motive of love rather than a motive of hating even the worst evil, things go way better for you. And you get more power given to you that you can use for good if you're not hating evil or fearing it or fearing anything. Fear does absolutely has no benefits that I've ever heard of anybody ever finding, because you don't even, you know, if God is infinite love, you don't need to fear infinite love. Okay. It's not going to hurt you. So, I know this is a concept that a lot of people would, you know, probably hate me for and say that you're completely crazy, but on the higher levels of reality, this fear and anger and hatred stuff doesn't exist. It's not good against evil at the ultimate higher levels. It's just overwhelming, indescribable, unconditional love. And if you can connect yourself back to that, even if you have to be fighting on the physical level, the results are going to be really different, just like Dee found out with the phone scam stuff. You can either protect yourself or be protected. You have a choice. And it's more fun to start experiencing this energy protecting you. So I recommend it to anybody that wants to play with that a little bit. So see what you can do during the week, and really appreciate having this time with you. Look forward to seeing you next week. But also, if you can be there tomorrow night, Sunday, 6 p.m. Pacific, 9 p.m. Eastern, lostartsradio.com. I'm sorry, blogtalkradio.com/lostartsradio. And you can hear it or you can listen to it, even though we don't take call-ins. You can still listen to it at 657-383-1002 every week at that time on Sunday night. And if you happen to be walking around with enough money and you want to help us stay on the air or continue our, actually it mainly continues the work of the Research Institute, which is behind all of these things. It's not the same legal entity as Lost Arts Radio, but it will be a benefactor of Lost Arts Radio, which it's legally allowed to do in this country according to the tax code. And also it'll be behind starting various ambitious demonstration projects that we have in mind to actually let people experience what it's like harmonizing your life with the basic design principles in nature and with the source of where we came from. And disease just is not an issue. It's a side effect is those things disappearing. And what's even more amazing is what happens to your conscious experience of daily life. We want to not just talk about that, but actually set up a school where that is demonstrated, and takes tons of money. So I'm hoping that we run into some donors that believe in that sort of thing and have at least a little bit to contribute. So if you feel like it, the donate button is on lostartsresearchinstitute.org. And that's tax deductible, IRS recognized nonprofit charity, public charity. And other than that, it's very helpful, even if you have no money to help us with, if you just tell other people about the two shows, Saturday morning and Sunday night, that's an immense service that we really appreciate. Go to the website, the radio website is lostartsradio.com. I know I'm not updating it as often as I should. I really try to do better with that. My time is so overwhelmingly filled right now. I'm trying to learn more about organizing it better and getting more done. But there's still a lot of good stuff on that site. All the archives of the shows back to the beginning are there. They're all free. And lostartsresearchinstitute.org is a just beginning site, but it still tells a little bit about the project and opportunity to support it. Other than that, hope you have a great week, and I look forward to meeting you here again next Saturday at 8 o'clock Pacific, 11 Eastern, and we'll be thinking about you till then. Good luck with everything you're doing, and thanks for coming.